is beginning to rain, rain, rain in the voice of our Father. Saying whosoever will come drink of this water, I promise to pour my spirit out on your sons and your daughters. If you're thirsty and dry, look up to the sky. It's beginning to rain.
Hello, friends. This is Tex Mars, inviting you to worship with us today at Bible Home Church, coming to you from Austin, Texas. Hello, friends. Great to be with you today here at Bible Home Church. You know, we're going to continue our series on Satan's plan for a one-world religion. But first, we always have beautiful music, and we have Johnny Ray Watson ready to go again. Don't you think it gets sweeter? Now, I'm going to be right back to introduce our program today and to take care of a few details, but right now, here's Johnny Ray Watson.
Proclaim, yeah.
Thank you, Johnny Ray Watson. You know, as we move into a study of today's message and our continuing series, Satan's Plan for a One World Religion, I'd like to bring up a very important and vital issue with you. I received a magazine today, and it doesn't matter what magazine, because this is so common today. In fact, I believe this is the prevailing view of the Bible among almost all, virtually all, evangelical churches today. And I mean so-called Bible churches, Baptist churches, Pentecostal, and so on. I want to read to you a letter to the editor of this magazine and what the editor of this magazine had to say. And I want you to discern, use your powers of discernment that God has given you, and using righteous judgment to determine whether this could be so. A man wrote the editor of this magazine and complained about the King James version of the Bible. And he said, and he praised the newer versions of the Bible, and he asked this question, to the editor, he said, "Wouldn't the church of our day do well to move away from the King James version?" Now, here was the answer. And again, now, this is the most popular answer today. I've read this again and again. Magazines such as Christianity Today, Moody Monthly, many of the prophecy magazines. I hear it from pastors, from Christians. This is the popular prevailing view today. Here was the answer. In other words, the question is, should the church move away from the King James because it's too old-fashioned, in other words? And these new versions seem to be so much easier in their English. Here was this man, this editor of this Christian magazine's answer. He said, quote, "The opinion of dedicated servants of the Lord relating to Bible translations differs widely, but we all agree on one thing. The Word of God is perfect, but all translations are the work of men and therefore are subject to error. Nevertheless, God, in His grace, has seen fit to use thousands of different translations." And I read that, and as I said, it's the prevailing opinion. It's what any Southern Baptist, Pentecostal, Methodist, almost any pastor would tell you today. Now, as you get into the liberal churches, I will agree, they will usually tell you the Word of God is not perfect. But these men, and particularly men such as the Southern Baptist pastors and Bible church pastors, and Bible Baptist so-called pastors, would very quickly tell you, oh yes, we do agree the Word of God is perfect. Now that's what this gentleman said here. That was his answer. We all agree on one thing, the Word of God is perfect. Now if we just left it at that, I have no objection. Would you? Probably not. The Word of God is perfect. However, notice, he didn't end there. The sentence, his answer, the sentence doesn't end. It has a comma and then the word but. You see, men who do not trust God's Word always have to interject the but. Now, here at Bible Home Church, we agree the Word of God is perfect, and we have no buts. We have no but. There's no words following that statement, the Word of God is perfect. But the rest of the world today, almost every church, 99.9999999% of the pastors agree with this statement, the Word of God is perfect, but all translations are the work of men and therefore are subject to error. Now, this man goes on to clarify it, and he says, and as your local pastor would probably tell you the same thing, or seminary president, whatever he would be, Nevertheless, God in His grace has seen fit to use thousands of different translations. In other words, He's saying, whatever the translation, God can use it. And there are thousands. Now, first of all, my friend, if it is true that the Word of God is perfect, but no translation is perfect, and all translations have errors, and all are flawed, then where can the Word of God be found today? I have asked this particular man, in fact, this editor of this magazine, I asked him face to face, I've met this gentleman before, and I asked him, where is the Word of God? He said, I use a certain translation. I said, is that the Word of God? He said, yes. Good, that it's perfect. He said, oh no, this translation is not perfect. I said, but the Word of God is perfect. He said, yes. May I see the Word of God that you use that's perfect? He said, well, I don't have it. I asked him, have you ever had it? Well, no, he said. I said, so you're using a Bible and you're teaching from a Bible that is not perfect. He said, that's correct. But you do believe the Bible is the perfect Word of God. That's correct. Why don't you use the Bible that's the perfect Word of God for your teaching? I asked him. He said, it does not exist. Now, friends, you know, it reminds me of the story that my dad used to tell so much, and I don't know why, but every time he told it, maybe it was just the way he told it. You know, he told a good joke. He's going to be with the Lord now. He's probably telling good jokes up in heaven. But he often told about the man that was selling apples down on a street corner back during the Depression. And people came up and asked the man, how much are your apples? One man asked him that question, and he said, well, my apples are 25 cents each. And the potential customer said, ooh, that's way too high. There's a man selling apples right around the corner, and he's just selling them for a dime. Why are yours a quarter? Well, the guy with the apples said, well, if he sells them to you for a dime, why don't you go buy one from him if he's right around the corner? And the customer, potential customer, said, well, he's out of them right now. He said, oh, well, when I'm out of them, I give them away for a penny each. When I'm out of the apples, I give them away for just 1 cent each. Here's a man that says he believes that the Word of God is perfect, but he says it doesn't exist. Nowhere on earth can you find the Word of God. But there are thousands of translations, all that have errors that God has given you to use. What a great God we serve. He writes the Word of God and makes it perfect, but then He hides it from us. Doesn't want us to use it. Why, if we could use it, it would be perfect. But since we don't have it, we're out of the Word of God. It's a lot cheaper today, isn't it? I mean, you can get thousands. They're all flawed. If you want to get the one that's perfect, well, these gentlemen don't know where it's at. You know, my friends, in the book 1984, the hero sort of character was a guy named Winston. And he gave a definition of freedom. And I've thought many years about that definition of freedom. At first I thought, it's too simple. It's only one sentence long, and it's very elementary. But the more I've thought about it over the years, the more I realize that Winston's definition of what freedom is all about is absolutely correct. And today, I long and I yearn for the kind of freedom that Winston defined in one sentence. Let me give you his definition of freedom. Freedom, he said, is the freedom to say openly that 2 plus 2 equals 4. You see, Big Brother had held up his, or the tormentor operating for Big Brother, the torturer, had held up his fingers. And he said, "How many fingers do I have, Winston?" And Winston looked, and it was apparent that he had four fingers. Winston said, "Four." Winston, of course, was being tortured, and they tortured him more. They said, "That's not the right answer." And he held up his hand again. Four fingers were displayed. "How many fingers do you see, Winston?" Winston said, "I see four." And they turned on the shock machine and gave him a tremendous jolt of electricity, and his body just reverberated in pain. "How many fingers do you see, Winston?" Winston said, "Oh, please, please tell me how many there are. I'll tell you anything you want to hear. Just don't hurt me anymore." He said, "Winston, you're beginning to learn that in Big Brother society, in other words, in Satan's world, 2 plus 2 does not equal 4. It can equal 3. It can be 5. It can be 7. It can be whatever we say it is, and we can change what it is whenever we want. It might not be 4 tomorrow, but it might be if we want it to be." Now, I don't know about you, my friends, but I want the freedom to say that when God said that he would keep his word pure and perfect forever, he meant it. 2 plus 2 equals 4. I don't care what the world says. I believe this, okay? I believe this. I have the freedom to say it, and I'm going to say it. The Bible is perfect. I do agree on it. I have no buts about it. And God's word is not subject to error. It is not flawed. And it's called the King James Version of the Bible. There are thousands of different translations of Satanic's polluted word. But if you want the real word of God, go to the Bible. And this man has to agree that 2 plus 2 does not equal 4. Or he would understand that if the word of God is perfect, but he doesn't have the word of God and it doesn't exist, then he's insane. I can only tell you, my friends, this is a definition of insanity. If you had a man that told you, "This piece of pie I'm eating is delicious," and you look down and he's fumbling at the air with a fork, and you see no piece of pie there, and you say, "What piece of pie?" He says, "Don't you see it? There's a piece of pie. It's a beautiful piece of pie. It's a great piece of pie. It's tasty. It's delicious. Don't you see it?" And you say, "There's nothing there." You're insane. You're a Looney Tunes. Take the man away. Lock him up. Put him in a straitjacket. I feel no different about all of these pastors. Are they not insane? They have no freedom. They are in bondage. They cannot agree that 2 plus 2 equals 4. They are so insane that they say the word of God is perfect, but it doesn't exist. It doesn't flow. It doesn't match. It's insane. And God said in his word that in the last days, the nations have gone insane. The nations have gone insane. Mystery Babylon has driven them crazy. And when I like the way he put it, the opinion, this was this editor of this magazine, the opinion of dedicated servants of the Lord, doesn't it sound so holy and righteous? The opinion of dedicated servants of the Lord relating to Bible translations differs widely. Let me tell you something, my friends. The opinion of dedicated servants of the Lord relating to Bible translations may differ widely, but I don't have an opinion on Bible translations. I have never had an opinion on Bible translations. I'm not in the category of people he's referring to. I know what God has said, and I can show you a dozen verses where he said he would keep his word pure forever. That's not opinion. I have no opinion on that. I know it's a fact. I don't have to give you my opinion. I hate a pastor who says, I think. Well, we're friends. If I read it in the Bible, I don't think. If John 3:16 says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have eternal life. I don't think that God gave his son. I know. And I don't have an opinion about Bible translations. I know they're evil. The only Bible you can trust is the King James Bible. But I want to ask you a question. Why would you want to go to a church where this man preaches? Why would you want to read a magazine that this man edits? He believes in a word of God that doesn't exist. And he says the one that he teaches from and reads himself has flaws. And I asked him, by the way, I followed up asking, where are the flaws in the Bible that you use? He said, well, I don't know. There's probably a lot of them I haven't found yet. He said he has found some, but not all of them. The man is a supreme idiot. And every president, every professor at Dallas Theological Seminary and Southeastern Theological Seminary and Fuller Theological Seminary and all the rest of them are insane. They do not have the freedom to say with unequivocal sincerity and conviction that 2 + 2 = 4. But I do. God made it a mathematical world, and it does. Maybe in some areas of earth, I could talk to mathematicians and they can say, well, you're not always right, Tex. Sometimes 2 + 2 = 4. Well, we'll let them stay in their little ivory tower, molting away, and we'll just go right on with the Word of God. There is a perfect Word of God. You can find it in the King James Bible, and you can take those other translations out, my friends, and when you get warm at night and you run out of logs, just go down and buy you a bunch of NIV, RSV Bibles, and keep yourself warm on them while you're reading your trusty King James Version, which is perfect. Okay, we're about out of time. I think we're going to leave that as a sermon for today because, you know, that's about Satan's plan for a one-world Bible. You know, this subject of the Bible translations is so powerful. So powerful. Satan thinks he's really done something great. Rather than just saying the Bible is flawed, he says, oh, the Bible is perfect. But every Bible that you would have in your hands is flawed. Every Bible that you can obtain to study is flawed. And nowhere in the world is there a Bible that you can hold in your hands and trust. They are all flawed. And then he has the audacity, he and his ministers of so-called righteousness, these so-called dedicated servants of the Lord, it's their opinion that it doesn't really matter what translation you read. They're all good. Even though I can show you translations where entire chapters are missing. But it's just as good as the translation next door. My friends, if your pastor says next week we're going to preach from Mark chapter 16, and you have an NIV, please don't go to church. Because the New International Version says Mark chapter 16 does not exist. There is no chapter 16 of Mark. You see what I'm trying to tell you? Don't even go to church if the pastor is going to preach on that. I gave you an example of a few weeks ago of a man with quite a nice sized ministry who put out a newsletter. And the gentleman said he now believes there's not one Antichrist with a number 666. For the last days, there's 3. How did he get that? Well, the NIV. So the NIV clearly shows the number 666 is not the number of a man. It's just man's number. You see what I'm telling you? I think that man went insane. He went insane. And now he's preaching and making other people crazy. The nations have gone insane. 2 + 2 = 4 to these people. I remember one man stood up at church, and you probably heard Baptists really love to do this. He said he believed everything in this Bible. I even believe the cover of it, he said. But he's one of those that when I asked him, he said, well, it's flawed. Well, where's the Bible you said is perfect? Well, it doesn't exist, he said. But you just told the people you believe the Bible is the perfect word of God. He said, well, I do. I said, which one? He said, the one that doesn't exist. You know, friends, these people are crazy. They're Looney Tunes. And if you stay in a church like that, you'll become a Looney Tune too. I recommend you run as fast as you can from such preachers. And the only question you need to ask a person is, do you believe the King James Bible is the perfect word of God and it has no flaws in it, is inerrant? If he says no, then run. You're in big trouble if you stay there. Isn't it wonderful, friend, to know that 2 plus 2 equals 4? Isn't it wonderful to know that God told the truth when he said he would keep his word pure forever? Isn't it wonderful to know that you can take that Bible and believe it and trust it? If you want to write to us, hey, you may not agree with me. You may believe there is no Bible you can hold in your hands anywhere in the world. I'd like for you to tell me why you believe that, if you do. I'd like you to tell me why 2 plus 2 does not equal 4. May God bless you, and I'll see you next week as we continue this wonderful series on God's Word. And we're going to expose Satan's plan for a one-world Bible even more next week.
If you're thirsty and dry, look to the sky. It's beginning to rain.
You've been listening to Pastor Tex Mars and Bible Home Church. Please join with us in worship next week as we continue to honor the remarkable Word of God.
It's beginning to rain, rain, rain in the voice of our Father. Then whosoever will come drink of this water, I promise to pour my Spirit out on your sons and your daughters. If you're thirsty and dry, look up to the sky. It's beginning.
Hello, friends. This is Tex Mars, inviting you to worship with us today at Bible Home Church, coming to you from Austin, Texas. Well, praise God for His Word. Praise God for your listening to this program today and being our friend here at Bible Home Church. We're going to have our series to continue now, which is Satan's plan for a one-world Bible. I mentioned, you know, that this was a chapter I discussed the same subject. Of course, now we're examining it in much greater depth, but it is discussed in my book, Dark Secrets of the New Age. Sister Gail Ripplinger wrote a tremendous book, New Age Bible Versions, all about it. But it's the most vital issue of our day. And the fact that you can go in Christian bookstores and ask the clerk there today what Bibles they have for sale, what versions and so forth, and ask them which one is the perfect Word of God, and they will say, well, they all have errors in them, but just pick the one that is your preference. And I like the pastors who say, well, I prefer this version, or I prefer that version. And, you know, Jesus Christ and His Word are not pro-choice. You can't choose which Bible you like the best. The fact is, my friends, God's Word is God's Word. Neither can you copyright the words of God. Every one of the new versions, of course, is copyrighted. And if you say too much, if you quote from the Bible too much, for example, in a book or article, you're supposed to get permission from the publisher. They're copyrighted. Now, friends, copyright law says that whatever you copyright must be your own work. Now, I wonder how a publisher can take the words of someone else, in other words, God Almighty, and say they're his. That's what they do. I'm waiting for the first court case where they sue somebody for, you know, not having permission to use the NIV or the RSV or the New American whatever version. Thousands of new versions, and they're all copyrighted. You know, I'd like to quote them, even though they're evil, just so I can go to the courthouse. If they would sue me, maybe I could entice them to sue me. And then when I get to court, I just tell the judge, well, this is the word of God, they say. It's not even their words. Well, this copyright is a fraud. They've copyrighted the words of God up in heaven. And not only that, they're not sure they're accurate. They admit they're not sure that these are perfect. They say, yeah, it's probably flawed some. These Bibles are frauds. I wonder if we should not write letters to the Federal Trade Commission, to the Attorney General of the states, of the various states. Tell them there's frauds being sold about. They're making claims that are not true. They're saying this is the Word of God. If it's the Word of God, how can they copyright it? It's not theirs. Oh, well, they say only the translation is copyrighted. Only the words we chose. Oh, well, you chose the words. They're not God's word. Well, not exactly. I'd just love to see them sweat a little bit. Wouldn't you? Well, my friends, listen. God gave his word, and you don't have to worry about a copyright. You know, you can take the King James Bible, and you can go down to a printer, and you can have 1,000 copies printed up if you can afford it. And you can give them to missionaries all around the world. And nobody's going to come back and say, uh-oh, that's copyrighted. You can't do that. And if they did, you just laugh at them. You can't copyright God's words. We don't own his words. We're just very fortunate to even have them. We thank God for them, that he left them for us and left them pure. But they're not our words. We can't do anything but just duplicate them and send them out. That's all you can do. Well, we're going to continue our series, as I said. But first, you can write to us, and we'd love to hear from you. We'd love to know that you appreciate what we're trying to do here, what actually we're doing. One thing we're doing is making people good and mad. I've always liked to do that. I've always enjoyed it immensely. I remember the preacher from way back in the days of George Washington. He sent out a young preacher. They just laid hands on him and ordained him, and they sent him out to preach, and he came back to see the senior pastor after, you know, performing as a good evangelist and going out and preaching at little towns. And the senior pastor said to the young preacher, he said, well, did you get anybody saved while you were out there preaching? He said, no, not a one. I preach, and not one person came forward at invitation time to be saved. Well, the pastor looked at him and said, well, that's okay. Did you at least get somebody angry? And I like that. Did you at least get somebody angry? Well, see, if he got somebody angry, at least he accomplished something out there. And I believe that too. Because, you know, a lot of people they're just naturally offended by the Word of God. They just don't like it. And I say, well, heap it on. Give me that opportunity. Sometime I wonder if maybe hell is going to be different than we think it is. Can you imagine a hell where all of these people that hate the Word of God are strapped down to a table, and you put, earphones on, and then you just turn up some melodious voice just reciting the Holy Bible, all 66 books, over and over and over. And they know they're down there in that horrible, slimy, filthy, hot place called hell. And all day long, the words are in their minds, from Genesis to Revelation. Now, that'd be a real hell for them, wouldn't it? Knowing that even though they heard those words and now finally realized Jesus Christ was alive forevermore and they had rejected him, they could never act on those words. No matter how much they prayed and asked Jesus to forgive them of their life on earth, it's too late. Boy, now that would be a hell. Well, I'll tell you what, we're going to have a piece of heaven right now for you. We'd love to hear from you if you're able to, and the Holy Spirit leads you. We'd appreciate your love gifts to this ministry so we can pay for airtime and pay for other expenses and keep right on going here at Bible Home Church, doing God's work, making people angry. And, you know, from the looks of things, we're saving souls too. And I appreciate the Lord doing that. I say we, the Lord will have to forgive me. I simply meant that we preach and the Holy Spirit draws whosoever he will. And that's the way it works in Holy Land, my friend. We just tell you the truth, and you know, God does the rest of the work. I'm just not strong enough to save anybody. Never saved a person in my whole life. But I have preached to quite a few, and the Holy Ghost saved them by drawing them to God, to Jesus Christ. You know, that's the work of the Holy Ghost. He points people to the Lord Jesus. That's his only work, in fact, other than comforting Christians, pointing people to Jesus. Well, we've got Johnny Ray Watson lined up here, don't we, Sandra? And what's this one here today? I think it's something about starting from the start. Okay, a little bit more lively tune than most that we have here. But we haven't, friends, we're a long way from hip-hop, rap music, or rock and roll. Let me tell you, that stuff's from the pit of hell. And if you want to write me and get mad about that, see there, I bet I found something, Sandra, to get people mad at me. Yeah. If you want to get people mad, just criticize their music. Well, I'll just do that. Rock and roll, all that pit of hell stuff, we don't have that stuff in here. We like beautiful music that points people to the Lord and prepares the soul for a good message from the Word of God. And here's Johnny Ray Watson to do exactly that.
You are my heaven, all is forgiven, I'm in love with you. You put me together, my lust forever, I will live. I was in pieces, wrinkled with creases, until you came. Now I live only, simply to worship your name. Lost in a whirlwind that was spinning round. You stopped the spinning, gave me a beginning on solid ground. Now there's a purpose, life not a circus, since I found you, Lord. I'm yours forever, take me and never let me leave.
Lola Davis continues. She says, among the previously unavailable data are the Dead Sea Scrolls, the vast treasures of religious writings found in the Patola in Tibet, Christian writings deleted from the Bible, sure, during the 4th century, writings of Teilhard de Chardin, and previously carefully guarded knowledge of the ancient wisdom, including the writings of the Tibetan Jwal Kul in the Alice Bailey books published by the Lucis Trust, writings of mystics from various religions, the materials offered by the Rosicrucians, and many books on Buddhism and Hindu philosophies and practices. Davis says, quote, probably much of this knowledge could be advantageously used in synthesizing the major religions with a world religion for the New Age. You see the kind of materials that will be used and are now being used and incorporated into these false versions, but eventually we will have a one world Bible. Well, there's another New Age group called the Collegians International Church. They build themselves as the Church Universal of the New Age. And in my book, Dark Secrets of the New Age, pages 182 and 183, I discuss their plan, the same plan for a world Bible. They say that the mystery teachings of old must be incorporated into any such document. And then here is what the Collegians International Church states in its formal doctrinal teachings. And I quote, humanity today is ready for the mystery inner teachings. Your search for these inner teachings is likely to take you to both the historic and esoteric literature of the mystery schools. Now, they continue. They say, quote, for centuries these teachings have been preserved and the inner knowledge discreetly passed on. Some of the movements which have kept alive these teachings in the West throughout the centuries have been Gnosticism, Freemasonry, Jewish Kabbalism, and Rosicrucianism. To broaden our perspective, says the Collegians International Church, we should add the esoteric literature that is behind most of the world religions. This literature includes books like the Hindu Bhagavad Gita, the Tibetan Book of the Dead, the writings of Theosophist Alice Bailey. Put it all together, says the Collegians International Church, and combine it with a study of the Kabbalah, add a touch of soul, bake under pressure for many lifetimes, and presto, purified enlightenment. Well, as we can see, the New Age Bible will contain countless lies and blasphemies distributed to the masses, and they'll be expected to shape their lives according to it. Oh, how wise was God when he told the Apostle John in Revelation 22, verses 18 and 19, about the dangers of adding to or subtracting from the Bible. If any man shall add unto these things, God shall add unto him the plagues that are written in this book. And if any man shall take away the words of this book, of this prophecy, God shall take away his part out of the book of life. Well, these are simply doctrines of devils being incorporated into our Bible. Why? Well, Lola Davis gives the reason in her book, Toward a New Age World Religion. She says, quote, a New Age world religion is needed to synthesize scientific knowledge with spiritual teachings and to unify mankind. Now, friends, they will not accept a Jesus Christ on the cross, God in the flesh who died for our sins and gave his precious blood. That's what they won't accept. David Spangler, in his book Revelation, The Birth of a New Age, claims that a God-like figure gave him a new Bible. And here's what this false Christ told him. Quote, if what Christ represents demands suffering, repentance, and self-negation, then this needs to be seen clearly in contrast to the New Age. That's right. He says the New Age doesn't call for suffering or repentance. And then John Randolph Price, head of the Planetary Commission, in his book Super Beings, claims, quote, the Bible was not intended to be interpreted liberally in all its parts. The idea of original sin, for example, writes Randolph Price, is totally false. The high religion
has nothing to do with sin, only the spiritual development of man. Now, friends, you have to understand then, the exaltation of man, really, ultimately the worship of the devil, is what is planned for us. Well, in a new book out called Spiritual Politics, we find even more revelations. Now, this is a book just out now called Spiritual Politics. On page 236, it talks about the divine plan of the great architect. Well, the same terminology the Freemasons use. It says there is a unifying spirit of loving understanding and mutual tolerance at work in the world. It says the enlightened ones from behind the scenes want us to have love, unity, cooperation, and freedom. There are three words to the plan, they say. Unity, peace, and plenty. Unity of all the religions, and of course, naturally, all the Bibles then. That will bring peace and plenty, say the authors of Spiritual Politics. Now let me read what they say on page 238. Quote, in religion, the plan will manifest as a worldwide understanding. Well, that's what a one-world Bible will bring, a one-world planetary understanding. It says, quote, this will lead to the fellowship of religions and coordinated planet-wide modes of worship and invocation, led by those who are wise and compassionate. That is the plan, then, of the New Age, to put it all together as one, to bring in a world Bible, or at least to pollute God's Bible so badly that it doesn't matter which Bible you use. They're all satanic Bibles. Now, this same plan was expressed in September 1950 in the Scottish Rite of Freemasonry's journal, The New Age. In an article entitled God's Plan in America, C. William Smith, a high-ranking Mason, stated this. He says, God's plan, now remember now, this is not Jesus Christ, this is the Freemasonry God, Lucifer. God's plan, writes Smith, is dedicated to the unification of all races, religions, and creeds. This plan, dedicated to the new order of things, is to make all things new, a new nation, a new race, a new civilization, and a new religion, which has already been recognized, writes Smith, and called the religion of the great light. Well, that's approximately the same thing that World Goodwill, a Lucis Trust affiliate, said in 1993 in their World Goodwill newsletter, number 4. They call 1993, for example, a year of interreligious understanding and cooperation. They said because of the Parliament of the World's Religions that was held in Chicago, there is the birthing of a global spirituality. Well, what they're after is a new Bible, and that will bring together all of the world's religions. You know, in his book, First Lady of the World, that I exposed not too long ago in my newsletter Flashpoint, Robert Mueller, one of the top New Age leaders, talks about the plan for the future. Now, by the year 2000, says Mueller, and I'm quoting from page 75 of his book, the plan calls for, quote, harmony with the heavens. The religions, writes Robert Mueller, will have produced a code of cosmic laws to be followed by all peoples and groups on our celestial body of earth. Did you get that, friends? Robert Mueller, former Assistant Secretary General of the United Nations, says by the year 2000, the religions will have produced a common code of cosmic laws, and these must be followed by all peoples and groups. Satan is indeed alive and well in the world. Now, is that a rash statement, you think? Could Satan really be involved in this? I'm going to prove to you now that he is indeed involved in this plan for a one-world Bible. And I'm going to prove to you, too, that whether it's the New International Version that came out in 78, the New King James in 82, the Living Bible in 71, the Message in 93, the New American Standard in 63, the New Century Version in 83, the Amplified Bible in 64, and they go on and on. All of these Bibles are basically derivatives from the supposedly lost manuscripts that originally came out of Alexandria, Egypt. And God said, come out of Egypt. And there was a very good reason for that. Now, I want you to understand those things that came out of Egypt, these false Bibles, first were developed by the Gnostics. There was the center of learning of the Gnostics in Alexandria, Egypt. Now, if you don't believe that, well, then take it from Manly P. Hall, a 33rd degree Mason, in his book, The Adepts. He talks about the mystics and mysteries of Alexandria. He talks about the school of Gnosticism, the Gnostic libraries, and everything that they did. He talks about Origen and all of the other false teachers. Of course, Manly P. Hall believes that they're true teachers. You see, this is where the false versions first came from, Alexandria, Egypt, the supposed Christian church, which was actually the Gnostic church, the New Age church of that day. Ed Branch, former Air Force officer, writing in the End Times and Victorious Living, says that a layman can research the religious belief of Origen, who lived 184 to 254 A.D., he says also look up the beliefs of Marcion, Eusebius. And then you will see that Westcott and Hort in the 19th century had a corruption connection. That's right. They were connected with these Alexandrian versions of the Bible. And the Bible warns us, woe unto them that call evil good and good evil. Did you know also that Westcott and Hort used two major manuscripts, both proceeding from the Roman Catholic Church? The first was the manuscript known as the Sinaiticus, the second Vaticanus. These were the two manuscripts that they used to put together the Westcott and Hort manuscript, which is the underlying foundation of all the false new versions. Now let me tell you a little about these to show you that these were found in demonized places. That's right, that's what makes these Bibles demonized and of Satan. The Sinaiticus manuscript was discovered in a wastebasket. That's right, in a wastebasket in an Orthodox monastery at the foot of Mount Sinai in 1844 by a man named Constantine Tischendorf. I want you to get an understanding of this. A monastery at the foot of Mount Sinai in Israel in 1844. In a wastebasket. Well, let me tell you a little bit about that monastery. You see, a man named R.L. Hymers, a pastor from California, visited that monastery in 1987. And let me tell you why he now believes the King James is the true Bible. Because of the Textus Receptus, the true manuscript from which it proceeded. He says, quote, I became convinced of the superiority of the Textus Receptus, the King James, during a tour of the Sinai Peninsula in the summer of 1987. Writes Hymers, quote, my wife and I were part of an expedition which climbed Mount Sinai. After descending, we toured St. Catherine's Monastery, which is located at the foot of the mountain. I was struck, writes Hymers, by the queer and even satanic characteristics of this monastery. The skulls of monks from across the centuries are heaped in a large room. This heap of skulls is 7 or 8 feet high. The skeleton of one of the monks is chained to a door adjacent to this mound of skulls, left there as an ageless guard. Within the sanctuary at the monastery itself, Hymers continues, ostrich eggs hang from the ceiling. Lamps dimly illuminate the gloomy atmosphere, and strange drawings and unscriptural paintings decorate the entire edifice. We were guided, says Hymers, through this eerie church to the place where the Sinaiticus scroll has been kept by these monks across the centuries until it was discovered by Mr. Tischendorf, taken to Germany, and ultimately sold to Great Britain.
If you're thirsty and dry, look to the sky, it's beginning to rain.
You've been listening to Pastor Tex Mars and Bible Home Church. Please join with us in worship next week as we continue to honor the remarkable Word of God.
It's beginning to rain, 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 to the voice of our Father. Saying, whosoever will come drink of this water, I promise to pour my Spirit out on your sons and your daughters. If you're thirsty and dry, look up to the sky, it's beginning.
Hello, friends. This is Tex Mars, inviting you to worship with us today at Bible Home Church, coming to you from Austin, Texas. Well, praise God for this day and every day when you're in tune with the thoughts and desires of our Lord and Savior. I tell you, every day is a very happy day. In fact, it's really a matter of being with Christ and on that great journey. And one of the things you have to understand, my friends, about being with Jesus Christ is you start off as a saved person, as a new person. You know, a lot of people get the journey mixed up with the end objective. The end objective starts at the beginning with Christ Jesus. You know, there's a very strange verse in the book of Revelation that I have pondered quite often. It talks about the Lamb of God slain from the foundation of the world. Now, we know Jesus Christ supposedly around 2,000 years ago. The Lamb of God was slain, crucified, although he was totally innocent. He was crucified for our sins, not for anything he had done, but he willingly went to the cross. But the interesting thing about it is the Bible says that we look at it as 2,000 years ago. We have a date. Well, people are sort of mixed up on the date, but approximately, you know, it was this year, this month, and a lot of people want to fight and argue over the exact date, even the month or the year. But we know it was around 2,000 years ago. Now, here's what's very fascinating. The Bible looks at things God's way, and God doesn't really have man's time. Listen to me. When you get up in heaven, you're not going to have a calendar with the 12 months of the year like we have that are really based on pagan time periods anyway and mythological time periods. So God does not have our time. He doesn't have to live according to our thoughts. There are no 24-hour days. There are no 60-minute hours and 60-second minutes in heaven. Think about that, friends. Eternity is far, far different than anything you and I can imagine. And Jesus was slain from the foundation of the world. Wow. It just boggles your mind, doesn't it? Now, listen, let me tell you something else that'll boggle your mind. We also read in the scriptures that God chose you, if you're going to be his, if you are his, he chose you from the foundation of the world. Whoa! You say, well, I'm only, let's say, 40 years old. I'm only 50. I'm 30. I'm 20. However old you are. You say, well, how did God know about me? Way, way back then. He did. Can you believe he not only knew you, he foreknew you. And he knew what kind of person you were going to be. He knew whether you were going to accept him as Savior. Were you going to obey him? Were you going to believe and have faith in him? Were you going to accept the grace that he has offered every man, woman, and child on earth? He already knew in advance that you would come to him, that you would believe in him, that you would give your life to him. And he knew it before you were ever born, before your mother and father ever met each other.
He chose you, in fact. You thought you chose God. You know, I always found it entertaining when the Billy Grahams of this world say, yes, choose the Lord, choose to serve Him. Come forward and accept a personal relationship with Jesus. Well, I sort of understand from the human reasoning, they make sense. But really, from a spiritual point of view, that is simply ignorance, because God already had chosen you. Now, I understand you have to make a step too. It is true that you need to repent of your sins and accept and believe in Him and have faith in Christ. Give your life over to Him so that He can remold you and make you anew. But listen to me. He already knew you were going to do that. And if you're a person listening to this radio program who don't know Jesus, and you're going to continue to reject Him today and every day for the rest of your life, well, I'm sorry for you, but God knew that too. Did you know there are some people foreordained of old for condemnation? Judas was chosen to be condemned before he was ever born. He came into the world with God already knowing he was going to be condemned. And the Bible, the scriptures tell us that there are many who have crept in. They're like thieves. They sneak into the churches to break them apart. They pretend to be Christians. And the Bible says they are foreordained for this condemnation. Oh, God condemns such people. And you know, some people, I really believe, they don't even know that they are foreordained for condemnation. They actually believe they're Christians. That's why Jesus said on that judgment day, they come before Him and they say, Lord, look at all the things I did in Your name. Why, I cast out devils. In Your name. You know, they're not lying to Christ. Some of them are sincere. They sincerely serve the devil, thinking they were serving God. Why? Because they never gave their heart over to Jesus Christ. And they had blinders on. They were blinded their whole life. Blinded even into believing that they were doing God's service. Many of them will kill Christians. Literally will kill Christians in the last days and thinketh they do God's service. That's what Jesus said. And they'll probably go before Jesus on the throne and say, look, I had Jack and Bill and Larry. I had them all put to death when I was in a position of authority in that concentration camp. I did it for You, Lord. What they were teaching just didn't seem right to me. So I had them arrested and put to death. And God's going to say, they were My servants. And you put them to death. Depart from Me, you worker of iniquity. I never knew you. And there will be, Jesus said, there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. What a shock to these pretenders. And I believe the people who are giving us these false satanic Bible versions today are going to be chief among those who will be judged harshly by God. Now, love to hear from you. And of course, we would appreciate any love gifts, tithes, or offerings so you can help us doing God's great work here in these end times. Now, we have Johnny Ray Watson again. He's the one that sings our theme song, and he's going to sing One Day at a Time. Then after that, we'll have, I believe it's going to be our last segment today. We're going to have a conclusion, believe it or not, to what has been a wonderful series, because it's right from the Word of God, and it exposes the old devil's works called Satan's plan for a one-world religion. And if I have any time after this song and the message, I'll come back for a few concluding remarks. This is Tex Mars, and here's Johnny Ray Watson.
I'm old. I'm just a man. Help me believe in what I could be and all that I am. Show me the stairway I have to climb. One day at a time. today. Show me the way, one day at a time. Do you remember? I know you do, Lord. When you walk among men. Well, Jesus, you know you're looking glow, and it's worse now than then. We're pushing and shoving, they're crowding my mind. Lord, for my sake, teach me to take one day at a time. One day at a time, sweet Jesus, that's all I'm asking of you. Please give me the strength to do every day what I have to do. For yesterday's gone, sweet Jesus, and tomorrow
were guided, says Hymers, through this eerie church to the place where the Sinaitica scroll had been kept by these monks across the centuries until it was discovered by Mr. Tischendorf, taken to Germany, and ultimately sold to Great Britain. As I stood in front of the case where the Sinaitica scroll had been kept prior to its being stolen by Tischendorf, I had the distinct impression that nothing in the way of spiritual light could come from this place. Hymer says, quote, "This impression led me to re-examine the facts concerning the Westcott and Hort text and to come to the conclusion that their use of the Sinaiticus and Vaticanus scrolls as a basis for the new Greek text was spurious. I have come to the conclusion," he says, "that the Westcott and Hort text is a mutilation and that the Masoretic text and Textus Receptus, which are the basis of the King James Bible, are far superior. Therefore, I strongly defend the King James Bible as the most reliable translation of the Scriptures in the English language today." Well, if that's the origins of the Sinaiticus manuscript, a satanic manuscript found in a demonized place full of skulls and bones of dead people, then what about the Vaticanus that was used by Westcott and Hort? Well, listen to this. We read in O. Timothy Magazine, Volume 11, Issue 6, 1994, page 28, quote, "The Vaticanus manuscript was in the Pope's library in Rome, supposedly," I added the word supposedly, "since before 1481. It says, the enterprising Tischendorf," now remember, this is the same man that supposedly found this Sinaiticus manuscript in a wastebasket at this old manuscript, a monastery, the same man claims to have gotten a hold of the Vaticanus, the other manuscript, which he says he found at the Vatican, which had had it since before 1481. And finally, he published an edition of the Vaticanus in 1867. Yes, Tischendorf would be a very interesting man to research the history of, friends. Now listen to what O. Timothy writes. "These ancient codexes, the Sinaiticus and the Vaticanus, were preferred by Westcott and Hort and the editors of the English Revised Version of 1881, who had adopted the position that these oldest manuscripts were also the best." Well, that's where we get the new versions of the Bible, and that's why they're so dramatically different from the King James. For example, in Isaiah 14, verse 12, the name of Lucifer, the identity of Lucifer, whose destiny is the pit, according to Isaiah there, is omitted. Lucifer, taken out of Isaiah. Well, why would that be? Well, John Robinson explains why, I believe. In his book, A Pilgrim's Path, Freemasonry and the Religious Right, he gives us a few clues. Now, I want you to know that John Robinson is a Mason, recently passed away, who was viciously anti-Christian. And in this book, he explains how the new versions have helped to rehabilitate the image of Lucifer. He says, for example, that the great former sovereign grand commander of Freemasonry, Albert Pike, who wrote the book Morals and Dogma, which is the basis for all of modern Freemasonry, thought very highly of Lucifer. That's right, in Morals and Dogma, Albert Pike called Lucifer the light bearer. He says in the book, Pike does, is it he, Lucifer, who bears the light? Doubt it not. Lucifer, the light bearer, the God of light. He says the Christians are liars when they say that Lucifer is an evil, false god. Well, Mr. Robinson, in his book, A Pilgrim's Path, Freemasonry and the Religious Right, says that Albert Pike is correct. Why, Lucifer's gotten a bum deal over the centuries from the Christians. And why? Well, on pages 48 through 54, he explains. It's because of that mean old King James Bible. He says, Lucifer became a disobedient angel, according to the King James Bible. He was cast out of heaven to rule eternally in hell. He says, quote, theologians, writers, and poets have interwoven the myth of Lucifer with the doctrine of the fall. And in Christian tradition, because of this mean old King James Bible, says Robinson, Lucifer is now the same as Satan, the devil. He's ironically the prince of darkness. He said, that's not true. Lucifer is a great ancient Latin name for the morning star. That's what the new versions of the Bible, the NIV and the others, say too, friends. The same thing the Masons are saying here. Fortunately, writes Mr. Robinson, there has been work on a new translation of the Bible. He says, there have been many imperfect translations, but now, with the new translations, Lucifer has been rehabilitated. He says, in these versions, there is, quote, no mention of Lucifer, no reference to any disobedient angel plunging to hell, nor should there be. The Masons are delighted, delighted to death, that Lucifer has been taken out of the Bible. Then, Manly P. Hall, 33rd degree Mason, he was claimed to be the greatest scholar. He was named that, the greatest scholar in Masonry of the 20th century. That was in Scottish Rite Journal. In his book, America's Assignment with Destiny, talks about, also about how the false gods of the past have been given a bum rap because of the King James Bible. He says that a man named Price, P-R-Y-S-E, published a better version of the Bible, in which he changed Matthew 10:16 so that Christians would understand that the snake bird, Quetzalcoatl, worshipped by the Indians, the ancient Indians down, the Mayans and the Aztecs and so forth, down in Mexico, would be something good and not bad. He says Mr. Price was a Greek scholar. His translation differed slightly from the King James. He felt that the great snake or serpent of the Indians had the same meaning as the dove, and that this creature combines serpent wisdom and should be our inspiration. You can read all about this on pages 31 through 33 of Manly P. Hall's books. The serpent as the bird of inspiration? Lucifer as simply the god of light, the light bearer? That's right, in the new versions of the Bible. Is that why, according to the Arizona Daily Star, friends, in Tucson, published Sunday, August 16th, 1992, was this article, Cursing and Violence Used to Sell Teens on the Bible? That's right. You see, according to this report, Turner Educational Services, you know, the Ted Turner people of CNN Network, well, they've got another company, could just call it Turner Educational Services. They've come out with a sort of a new Bible version, that's sort of the Bible according to MTV. They include modern words in it, foul ones, cursing, violent images, profanity, and violence. Well, they're selling it all on computer, CD-ROM. You can use it on your computer. My friends, these versions are getting worse and worse and worse. And you will find that the changes being made in the new versions go along with the New Age. For example, the New Age teaching that Jesus was not born of a virgin, could not have been, but was simply another man who earned his way to godhood. And that's why the RSV and many of the new versions take away the word virgin and insert, substitute, the lying term maiden. So that Mary was not a virgin, she was just a young maiden. Oh, that goes great with the New Agers. And then there's 1 John chapter 5, verse 7, that says there are three that bear record in heaven, and these three are one. That's right, three, the Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost. The Father, the Word, and the Holy Ghost, to be specific, in the King James Bible. But the New Agers will not go along with that idea of the Christian oneness of the Trinity. For example, Foster Bailey of the Lucis Trust, formerly known as Lucifer Publishing, in his revealing book, Running God's Plan, says instead that the Trinity is, quote, Father, Mother, and Child. Well, that's the same thing that the Egyptians taught, the Babylonians taught. Let's look at another example. Did you know that in Revelation 13 it says, here is wisdom. This is in the King James. Here is wisdom. Let him that hath understanding count the number of the beast, for it is the number of a man, and his number is 666. That's right. Revelation 13 in the King James warns us that this Antichrist, the beast, will be a man. His number will be that of a man. Well, all of those people who don't want you to believe that the Antichrist is coming, they don't want you to believe that the Great Tribulation will overtake this planet. They want you to believe that there's going to be a new birth of this planet, a new planetary Pentecost, according to Barbara Marks Hubbard in her book, False Bible, by the way, New Age Bible, The Revelation. They want you to believe that everything is going to get rosier and better until the New Age peace and plenty and prosperity era comes upon this earth. Is that why they've taken out this Antichrist? That's right. You read the new versions of the Bible, and they have taken Revelation 13, that final verse, and they changed it. It no longer becomes that his number will be that of a man. Instead, it will be man's number. Man's number. Let me read it to you very quickly. Here it is from the NIV. It says, quote, this calls for wisdom. If anyone has insight, let him calculate the number of the beast, for it is man's number. In other words, well, all men are have problems, have imperfections. They're all striving toward godhood, the New Ager says, toward karma, toward balance and equilibrium, the Masons say, on their way to the divine, through the divine path and journey. So that's just man's number. There's no personal Antichrist, a man. That's just the number of all men who are not yet divine. And then we get to the Lord's Prayer. Read this in the NIV, in the Gospel of Luke, chapter 11, starting with verse 2. Here's what Jesus said. Now listen, can you see what's missing? Here is the false devil's prayer from the NIV Bible. It says, Father, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come. Give us each day our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, for we also forgive everyone who sins against us. And lead us not into temptation. That's the end of it. Well, you know what they forgot? In the King James, the word our before Father, the words which art in heaven that follow the our Father, those are missing. In the second sentence, hallowed be your name. How about thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven? All of that's missing from this false Lord's Prayer in the NIV. And then there's some other things missing. How about, but deliver us from evil? Satan doesn't want you to know that's in there. And it's not in the NIV, but it is in the King James. How about, for thine is the power and the kingdom and the glory forever? That's the great ending in the Matthew version of the King James. It's missing here in this version. And of course, we can go on and on with these lies in the new versions. Westcott and Hart, they detested the King James Bible. They worshipped Mary. They were secret closet Catholics, and they gave us the false new versions. And the Dead Sea Scrolls supposedly were found and kept at the Rockefeller Museum in Jerusalem. There again, we have a supreme problem. The Rockefeller Museum, the Dead Sea Scrolls, and now they're being used for these new Bible versions. There's so much more we could talk about. The fact that the New World Translation of the Jehovah's Witnesses also used the false Westcott and Hort manuscript. Friends, this is simply the lie of the servant, the lie of the serpent. Jesus said, it is written, man does not live by bread alone, but by every word of God. It's no wonder that the new versions have taken out the sentence, but by every word of God. This was the lie told in the garden, and now it's being told today. There is a plot for a one-world Bible. It will be the Christian and Jewish Bible, and it will be the lie of the devil from the very beginning of mankind on earth.
If you're thirsty and dry, look to the sky. It's beginning to rain.
You've been listening to Pastor Tex Mars and Bible Home Church. Please join with us in worship next week as we continue to honor the remarkable Word of God.